I'm Mark Kepler, Purdue University Cooperative Extension Service, located right here in Rochester at the fairgrounds. Today, it is just the start of April, and this is prime time to be pruning trees. So what I want to talk to people about today is the whole aspect of pruning trees. And what I want to get across is a variety of things. And some of those things are the growth of the tree, the type of tree, what that tree wants to do, and we're going to take a look at those issues as we come along. We're going to talk about branches, the angles of the branches, and we're going to talk about the different species and how it affects different species that we'll be looking at. It is really important for me to know why I want to prune a tree. Way too many times people will say, well, it's time to prune trees, so I'm going to go prune trees. You have to have a reason to prune a tree. And that's some of the parts of the things we're going to get across today as we go along. So I start out with, I brought a branch with me that I've cut off of a tree, and we're going to pretend that this branch is actually a tree. And if I look at this thing, it's a nice straight tree growing up straight and tall. This is the kind of tree we would find growing in a wooded area where there's a lot of other trees growing around it. Because these trees, most of our species, grow very straight and tall because they are reaching for the sunlight. And sunlight is a very important part of this whole process, and this is one of the instrumental factors that we're going to have in the growth of this tree. It's reaching for sunlight. And because a tree growing in the woods is reaching for sunlight, it grows up fairly straight and tall. Sometimes it'll bend or angle or do something like that to go for that sunlight. So let's think about this one right here is our tree that's growing out in the woods. And so with this tree growing in the woods, it's growing up very straight and tall. What'll happen sometimes is, or this could be my tree in my yard too, whatever happens sometimes is we take a look at this bud. On the top of this tree is a bud. That single bud at the top of there is the bud in charge. I call it the general. And really it does, it controls the rest of the growth of this tree. And because the bud at the top is in charge, as it grows up straight and tall, that bud keeps it growing and keeps the other buds under control. If you come along and you kill this bud off, all of a sudden there is nobody in charge, and the rest of the tree then kind of does what it wants to do and kind of starts branching out all over the place until another bud comes along and becomes that bud in charge. Now, let's look at this tree right here. Right there is the bud at the top of the tree. In fact, it almost looks like this tree has died at the top and it's been a bud that's out the side that's going to take charge and it's going to go up. So let's take, for example, let's say this is my tree growing in my yard and it's really a tough winter and maybe that top bud has died, or maybe the rabbit's a short tree and the rabbits have come along and ate off the top of it, or maybe the deer have come along and ate off the top of it. So I'll take my pruning shears out and I will pretend that I am a rabbit and I have just cut off the top of that tree. Now, what's going to happen to this tree is there is no longer a bud up here at the top in charge. And so this bud, and maybe even this bud down here will decide to grow out. And so instead of having one bud go up straight and tall, now I have one, two, or three different ones coming up. So I've switched over to a different branch off that tree, and I look at this one here, and this could be what would happen if that bud would have died. Notice that there are two different branches coming out of there. Instead of having one, we have two going up. And you say to yourself, well, what's the big deal with that? Well, now this tree no longer has one central leader, it has two of them. And from this point on, from this spot right here on, this will now have two branches coming up. I have the mistaken belief that trees grow like this, and they do not. Trees grow from the tips of the branches out. So what's wrong with this? Well, because maybe a windstorm will come along sometime, and this angle we have of the branch right here is a very narrow angle. The closer we get those branch angles together, the easier it is for them to break off and split. The more farther apart, the better. A good example would be one like we see in this tree. Let's take a look back at this tree. just like I said, we've got these two branches here, and we've got this very narrow branch angle. So this very narrow branch angle is more susceptible to splitting out. And let's take an example. I'll take a hold of this one, and I'll take a hold of that one. And with a slight amount of pressure, it just rips right down the side. And look at the damage we have done. Now this is a very small twig, but if this was a bigger tree, maybe a foot in diameter or so, all this area right down through here would have been damaged in that split. And so as a tree grows, it has to cover that wound up. Trees don't heal, they only cover. And so eventually the bark would have to come around and keep coming around and keep coming around and keep coming around. It would take years to cover up this kind of a split like this. So because it takes years to cover up that split, we don't want that split to ever happen. So this limb, if I can put it back, would have been a great example of a limb that needs to be pruned off. This would have been the straight up one, the main central leader. This would have been the limb that should have been pruned off. So what is a good example of a very young tree that I have just planted in the ground, and it's because it's very young, this is an example of when I need to prune. So I bring my pruners out at a young age and I take off this branch. And when I take that branch off like that, then that tree would have allowed itself to grow straight and this would have continued as my central leader. It's a real interesting concept when we look at it. A tree, when its seed is planted in the ground, that tree has a genetic height it's going to get to. And so that seed I plant in there, if it's an oak tree, it's going to get to be 70 or 80 feet tall. If it's a redbud tree, it's only going to get to be maybe 20, 25 feet tall. So we have a variety of genetics going on here. But if I come along with this tree here, and let's say I did like I did, I take it and I do cut off part of the top of the tree, that's not the end of the growth of that tree. That tree still wants to get 80 foot tall. And so it will send out buds and continue to go on up. And no matter how many times I prune the top out of that tree, it will continue to keep going and going to get to that height. And so many times people in the pruning process want to control the height of a tree. And controlling the height is just not possible unless you're going to prune. Let's take a look at some of that. So let's follow up on our discussion we were just talking about, and I've come over to this tree over here. If we take a look at this tree, this is a maple tree. Genetically, it wants to get maybe 60 foot tall up in the air, and that's what we're going to be taking a look at. But very young in the life of this tree, something happened. And what ended up happening was that main central bud that we talked about got cut out. So let's take a look here and see what the results of that is. Clear down here at the bottom, we have this V. Again, it's a very, very narrow angle. And because it's a narrow angle, that will be very susceptible to blowing out in a windstorm. So as we look at this tree, we see that very narrow angle. Let me come on down here and look at some more of this. Not only is this angle narrow, but right in here, the bark is growing together. This tree is growing out bigger. This tree is growing out bigger. And eventually the two of them will be hitting each other, and eventually they'll be pressing against each other so that our pressing between the two of them there will end up shoving themselves apart. Both of them will be pulling at each other from apart, and so they'll have a pressure. We call this a bark inclusion. And what ends up happening is this is a very weak situation, because not only is the joint itself or where it comes together weak, but now it's pressing against each other and trying to push it apart. And that's when you get that windstorm, and this type of tree will end up splitting out and dropping on you. So my decision should have been a long, long time ago when this tree was very, very young. I needed to be using these pruning shears. I needed to come out here and make a decision as to which one of these to keep and which one of them to allow to grow on up straight to be my shade tree. And in this situation with this tree, with one branch going out towards an angle like this and one of them going up fairly straight, I would still make that decision today to take off this side of this branch and take it off. Now, a lot of people don't like doing that, but in the long run, when the winds are here, this type of branch will maybe end up splitting off and dropping off of there. Tell you a little story. In front of my house is a wild cherry tree. At a very young age, about this size, it came up with three different sprouts coming off of there. And they turned into great big branches. And so I had a tree with three big branches coming off of there. One day I got a wind, and the wind came along, split one of them branches off, went over the road, took out my electric for 2 days, and at the same time, a car popped over the hill and hit that tree that was laying across the road. It's really important to try to prune these trees at a young age. Part of the process that we have to look at when we take a pruning cut off a tree is really understanding this pruning business. And it all starts out with another branch that I've got here. And it starts out with an area we call the branch collar area. Where this branch, this is our main stem right here, where this branch on the, it comes into this point right in here, there's an area of wrinkled tissue we call the collar. That area of wrinkled tissue is the part that once we prune this off, it'll come out and it'll cover that area up. So let's talk about a good pruning job and a lousy pruning job. All right, first off, if I was to prune this branch that we've got right here, if I was to prune it, let's say out here, okay? If I was to make that branch pruning out there, this branch would come back to this little spot right here where there's a bud at, and that's where the bud would start growing out. All this tissue up here, because there is no bud above it, will end up dying. So this area will die back to that little bud right there, and this thing will continue out, but this will all die. And so, meaning it dies, meaning it sits there and it rots and it rots and it rots, and eventually it'll fall off. Let's take this tree back a little further. Let's say that I was making this pruning cut right here. Well, there is no more buds out here left on this branch. And because there's no more buds out here, this whole branch will die and it'll rot and rot and rot and eventually fall off. In the meantime, this thing we call the branch collar area, this wrinkled tissue right here, will be kind of sitting there growing and growing and growing, but it can't go around this branch because it's got all this branch in the way. So a proper pruning cut is just on the other side of that branch collar area, right like that. Now, that wrinkled tissue will slowly come around here and eventually cover and cover and cover that branch to the point where this branch now won't have a big gaping rotting hole in it. Let's take a look at this tree behind us here and show you some examples of areas that have been pruned properly where that branch collar area has had an opportunity to cover that up. So here's a good example of an area of a branch that has been pruned off. And the branch collar area was this part right in here that was left on it. And over the years, and it takes many years, this has started to come up and it's covering, 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 and covering. And this was a very, very good cut. The cut right above it up here was one that left a little bit of a branch area out there. And because it left that little bit of a branch area out there, it died, this is dead, but it's taken some time for this collar area to start coming over that and covering that area up. Let's go up to another one, this one right here. It's a very good example. Right here is the branch collar area on this one. And it's trying to cover it up, but it's got this stub left in the way. So really this should have been cut back a little bit further, about my finger width back into this location. And that would have been a good spot to cut it. In fact, because it did send out a bud right there, and the bud has created a little branch, and this will be another little tree area right through here, and that'll eventually have to be pruned off of this thing too. So it's really important to understand those colors and how they work. And so when I'm pruning a tree, I want to prune it like this, where I've got those colors so they will cover up that branch. If I just cut a stub off of there, it really can result in a lot of damage to that tree later on, with rotting going right into the main trunk of the tree. So you've planted a tree in your yard, and it's up to you to get it to grow and grow the right way. And I use this tree behind me as an example of something that ends up happening. Here's a couple things. This is why we want to prune young trees. Big old trees, other than a few dead branches in it, I really try not to prune them. Every once in a while you see people give them haircuts, cut the branches off the top. That's not good for them trees at all. But this young tree back here, we want to prune that thing as it grows up. So let's take a look at some things. Number one, this branch is right about nose height with me. Eventually this branch is going to come out and the branch is going to come down. There's going to be come downs and it's going to be hitting us as we walk across the yard. These types of branches are the ones that need to be pruned off at a young age. And this would be a good example. Right here is that branch collar area, that swelling of the tissue. So I could take that one off right there. And the one on the other side needs to come off. All these little branches here too, they need to disappear. Let's go up on this tree a little further. Let's follow this tree on up to this point way up here. At that point, you will see something has happened in the life of that tree to cause it to come out with four different branches. One out that way, one this way, one kind of straight up, and one out this way. When that happened, that was the time right then and there we should have been out here with our pruners and corrected that to begin with. So we've lost a lot of this already. So here's one of the things that I would do to this tree as we go on up. Those two branches going out to the side, they need to go. They need to come off today. This is a great time of year to do that. Then we're left with those two other big branches sticking up there. And then you say to yourself, can I fix this? Well, the answer is I'm not going to have a very good time trying to fix this because they're already set with their branch angles and that wideness that's come out with those different branch angles. So I may let that go, or if I wanted to risk it, I'd take this one off the side and it will look not very good for a couple years, but eventually it'll straighten itself up. Remember, this tree wants to get 60 foot tall. Well, when we start having branches angling like this and we have this going on, we see that happening, that we want to get rid of it. Another thing to take a look at, and I'll point this out, see my bark inclusions right there, right over there? Those are bark inclusions like I talked about earlier, and those are things that will eventually easily make that tree split off. And that's why we want to get rid of that. So you got to prune them at a young age and prune them as they go up. Because they're out here in this yard with all sorts of sunlight coming to them, they will have branches coming in, and sunlight coming in, they'll have branches sprouting everywhere. Your job is to play the woods, and that woods job is to keep them straight going for sunlight. You have to keep them pruned going for that sunlight also. Once they get to a certain point, let them go. But for right now, this tree ought to have these branches taken off of it, some of these down here, off down there, that and off the side, and then we're really only going to be left with those two branches up there at the top, and we may want to take one of them off. So these branches are totally unimportant and need to come off of here. It's kind of hard to imagine, but think of them a lot older, what they really want to look like, and that's why we want to take those branches off. Classic example of how not to prune a tree. We're going to take a look at this big old tree standing here. See this large foot in diameter branch sticking out that was cut off out here about 2 feet away from the tree? No way whatsoever for that branch to have any green tissue, to have any leaves so it can heal itself back over. So it dies and it goes back into the tree and it rots and it rots and it rots and it rots. And there's a great big old cavity going back in the tree, which will go right down that tree and go on down along. It could be handled by just being like the other branch up above it a little bit further, which was cut properly. And that branch has had that bark collar area cover it up. And now we don't have all that rot going on. We have some rot, but not like we have down below here. So this is a good example. Don't leave a stub. Allow that branch collar area to cover it up. That central leader is very, very important in these trees. And here's an excellent example at a very young age where that central leader was, that main top bud was killed off. And now out of this tree, we have one, two, these have been cut off, three, four, five, six, seven stems coming out of this tree. And so this is just going at all different angles and it looks very, very bushed out, you might say. So the potential for this tree, it still wants to get big and tall. It's getting up there as high as it can get, but these are very weak angles down here and easy to split out when that windstorm comes along. This is a perfect example of what not to do to a tree. This tree was going to get to a certain height. It was going to get to be 60, 70 foot tall. Somebody came along and said, you know what, I want this tree to be a nice round shape. And so they cut off the tops of all the different branches. And every single place where they cut those tree branches off, it sent out multiple buds and put up branches. And so this tree has lost its main growing point and it'll be kind of a bushy tree, but it will still try to be that 60 foot tall. And look at those branches going straight up there. So once you've made this decision to do this, you're gonna have to come back and keep whacking this thing off year after year after year. This is not healthy for the tree because as you look at those branches up there, the buds popped out below that cut will die back and it'll rot back into the stems and continue to rot back in there. And eventually it'll cover itself up, but after it's rotted for a long period of time. Trees do not need to be treated like this. This is the wrong thing to do to a tree. That tree has got the genetics to be a big, tall tree. Let it be that. You don't see trees in the woods that look like this. This is not the way to prune a tree. People ask me about pruning evergreens, and evergreens are just a different situation altogether. So when I talk about evergreens, I'm talking about pines and spruces and firs, those types of things. I'm not talking about yew bushes in my yard. I'm talking about evergreen trees. With an evergreen, what'll end up happening is this spring, and we'll take a look right down here. This spring, these little spots right here, these little buds right there will grow. And it'll produce a thing they call a candle. And it comes out about this far. If I want to prune this tree and keep this tree from getting bigger and bigger, wider, I should say, then all I do is I just come along and I break off those candles at sometime in June and bust them off. When I have a, wherever I bust them off, they'll just do like the other tree did and they'll send out multiple buds. Instead of having one coming out straight, now I'll have two or three coming out of that bud. That's how our Christmas trees are so full. This is a white pine tree. This would be a lousy Christmas tree because it's not very full. Christmas trees are very full because they come along and shear them all the time, cut those off and make them buds after buds after buds come on there. The other important thing about an evergreen tree is if you think this tree has gotten too big for you and you want to prune it back, well, you're in for a surprise because if I prune this thing back anywhere to the brown, as long as I've got green here, I can get in here and I can prune this up. But if I prune an evergreen back into the brown, like back into those areas, that's it. That's the end of the tree. A deciduous tree that has the leaves on it, like the maples, you can prune them back there and it may send out buds and go from there. But an evergreen tree does not send out buds back in the brown. So I always tell people, once you prune back into brown or gray in this situation, that's it. You're not going to go any far. The other thing is if I prune that branch clear back into there, there's no sunlight coming down anyway for that bud to grow with. And so because of that, it's going to have a difficult time. It just won't reproduce and won't come back into that area with more branches. So evergreens are totally different. So think about keeping them small or keeping them stocky by breaking off those candles that we talked about at an early age, and that's how you can keep them pruned back. But other than that, that's the only way you can really prune them. Once they get overgrown, you're done with them. I'm Mark Kepler, Purdue University Extension, and I really come out to this location today to talk to you about, I think, one of the most unique diseases of trees that I get to deal with people. This is a cedar tree behind me. And if you look all over this cedar tree, there's a bunch of little brown balls just all over this tree. We're talking about a disease called cedar apple rust. And what's so unique about it is it takes two. It takes the cedar tree or an apple and an apple for this to conclude itself as a disease cycle. Now, hawthorn sometimes will substitute as an apple, and there are some other diseases that come into play. But what is really unique on this tree is all them little brown balls you see there. At one time in the past was something like I've got in my hand here, and that is a ball, a kind of an orangish looking ball. And I've even split it open there for you to take a look at that. What that is a fungus disease. And this fungus disease has come over to this tree and infected this tree. And this tree doesn't look too healthy. And infected this tree and come a little bit later on in this spring. This is right now around the 1st of April. Later on this spring, these will turn into orange gelatinous masses that just kind of always describe a kind of a jello look on the tree. Just an ugly look to it all. That orange gelatinous mass will then shoot out the spores. Those spores will then go find a hawthorn or an apple tree, land on that apple, land on that apple leaf, and it can the fruit too, and infect it, and then it produces spores from that that will end up being produced and come back over to this cedar tree. It takes two. You do not find this disease where there's apple trees without cedars around, or arborvita. The arborvita are in the same cedar family. Or you don't see it on cedars unless there's an apple tree around. And not too far from here are some apple trees that causes this disease, or gives this disease a chance to go back and forth. On this tree are some old ones from the years past. And this one I've got in my hand is very, 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 very easy to break up. It's easy to do. This is the one that's going to explode into that orange mass this year. Versus one of these, like this one over in here, some of these smaller ones that have been here from years past and really are hard to break up and very difficult. In fact, there's some very, very old ones here that I'll take an opportunity to show you that already have been here, been on this tree for a long, long period of time. And this is an example of one of them. So we're going to take a look at this tree this summer and follow it through a little bit so you can see what happens to those gelatinous masses that come along, and take a look then later on at one of those apple leaves and see how it works on those apple trees. It does more damage by far to the apple trees, and there's a cousin to this thing called cedar quince rust, which actually goes between the cedar and a quince tree, but it'll also get on the hawthorn tree, and in which case it will really do some damage to the branches of that hawthorn tree. So we'll get a chance to look at that as the summer goes on.